Hello, everyone, and welcome to my channel. My name is Nick Malloy, and today I'm going to provide you with a demonstration of the tutorial, Digitizing Your Neighborhood. This demonstration is based on the written instructions provided to you in Canvas. Sometimes we update them, so you should always use the written instructions when following along this video. Also, check Canvas for specific instructions on what you need to turn in at the end. Different instructors might have different requirements for this assignment. Okay, so let's get started. Setting up your workspace. Begin by setting up your workspace. To do this, create a project folder on the computer desktop called Digitizing Neighborhood. Don't use any spaces in the name, which can cause problems later on. You can either delete the space or use an underscore. Next, you will set up the standard folder structure within this project. Create three subfolders, original, working, and final. The original folder is for storing unaltered copies of your data. The working folder is either for working copies of your data or data sets you create during the project. The final folder stores your outputs such as tables, reports, and final map layouts. This is the standard project structure that we use in this class, and it's designed to help you keep your data organized. Downloading the project data. Next, you need to download a copy of a NAIP image. You can find a direct link to this dataset in the instructions. It tends to save to your downloads folder automatically. Also, the file is very large, so it may take a while to fully download. Once you have it, copy it from your downloads folder to your original folder. Next, use 7-zip to decompress the file. One shortcut I like to use is a right-click drag on the zip file, which brings up the 7-zip options. If you can't get that to work, then right-click and show more options to get to the 7-zip menu. Use the Extract Here option when it comes up. Since the file is so large, it may take a while for 7-zip to decompress the file. Once it is done decompressing, go ahead and delete the original zip file. Then open ArcGIS Pro. Setting up a new project in ArcGIS Pro. You may be prompted to sign in if it's your first time working in ArcGIS Pro. If so, go ahead and sign in. On the ArcGIS Pro homepage, click Map under the New Project options. When the Create New Project window opens, name the project Digitizing Neighborhoods. It's fine to use spaces here. The next two steps are important, so don't skip them. Click the file folder icon to set your location to the Digitizing Neighborhood folder on the desktop. Then uncheck the box next to Create a new folder for this project. You would only leave this box checked if you started here and still needed to create a project folder. In this instance, you don't need to create a new project folder since you already did that earlier. When you create a new project in ArcGIS Pro, several elements are added automatically to your workspace files. Open the project folder in Windows File Explorer to see what's inside. You should notice that beyond the three subfolders you initially created, original, working, and final, a few other items are added to your workspace, such as a geodatabase and an ArcGIS project file. Never delete any of these folders or files from your workspace, or you risk corrupting your project. In ArcGIS Pro, you can see these default files in the Catalog pane by twirling open the folders. Adding the NAIP image to the map. We will use the NAIP image as a base map layer for this activity. By default, Esri will automatically load one of its base maps. In most cases, that's fine. However, for assignments in this class, you generally are not allowed to use Esri base maps in any final map layouts. So you should get into the habit of removing them if you have your own base map layers. I am using the dark gray base map, which has a reference layer for the map labels. In the contents pane, remove the base map layer and any reference layer that comes with your base map. Next, drag the file that begins with ortho and ends with .sid from the original folder to the map pane. It might ask if you want to create pyramids. Mine didn't, but if the message comes up, click yes. Determining the spatial reference system. Next, you need to check the spatial reference system the NAIP file uses. You can find this information in the layer properties. In the contents pane, right-click on the image layer and select the properties option. You can find the spatial reference information on the source tab. So it looks like this NAIP image uses the UTM system, which is a projected coordinate system. Specifically, it's going to be NAD 1983, UTM Zone 10 North. Make a mental note of this. In a later step, you're going to create a few shapefiles, and you want to be able to match the spatial reference system with a NAIP image. Finding your neighborhood. In ArcGIS Pro, zoom into your neighborhood. This tutorial assumes that you live somewhere in Hubble County. If you don't want to use your specific neighborhood, or if you live somewhere else, that's fine. Just pick a random neighborhood, or you can use the Cal Poly Humboldt campus. Creating new shapefiles. For this project, you're going to create three new shapefiles. One polygon shapefile for buildings, one polyline shapefile for roads, and one point shapefile for trees. You can create new shapefiles directly from the catalog pane. Just right-click on the working folder and choose New Shapefile. This will open the Create Feature Class tool on the geoprocessing pane. Because you right-clicked on the working folder, the feature class location is automatically filled out. For the feature class name, I'm going to call this one Buildings. Since buildings are polygons, make sure that the geometry type is set to polygon. Finally, you need to define the spatial reference system that this shapefile will use. You can use the drop-down menu under the coordinate system to pick the NAIP layer. ArcGIS Pro will then match the spatial reference. When you're ready, run the tool. The new shapefile gets automatically added to the contents pane. You should also see a copy of the shapefile in the working folder. Now I'm going to repeat these steps for the trees. This time I will choose point as the geometry type. Again, before I run the tool, I will match the spatial reference to the NAIP layer. After running the tool, this new shapefile also gets added to the working folder. Now I will repeat these steps one last time for the streets. And I almost made a mistake. The geometry type for streets is a polyline and not a polygon. After you're done, you should see three different types of shapefiles in the working folder, one for polygons, one for points, and one for polylines. You can tell the difference between these types of shapefiles by looking at the icon. There are subtle differences in the symbols that they use. Digitizing. Okay, so I've settled on a spot to digitize. It's in the middle of campus, and the buildings are nice and big. To start editing, go to the Edit ribbon and click the Create button. The Create Features pane will open up. All you need to do is select the layer you want to edit, and the editing tools will pop up near the bottom. The easiest tool to use is the Line tool. You can trace the edges of the building by clicking on each corner. When you're ready to close the polygon, all you have to do is double-click. I'll go ahead and try another building. This one's a little harder to see. The quality of this specific NAIP image is not that great. However, sometimes you don't have the option to get a better image, so using this one is good practice. This building's not a perfect square, so I will find the corners. When I'm done, I'll double-click. There are other tools as well. For example, here's a circular greenhouse. For this one, I'm going to try to use the circle tool. For this one, you need to click the center of the circle, then drag outward. When you're ready to finish, double-click. Go ahead and practice. You should digitize a total of 8 buildings. You also need to digitize at least 2 streets. The line tool for polyline shapefiles is easy to use. Just click at the start of a street segment, then double-click to create the line. Typically, you want each street segment to start and end at intersections. The next one is even easier to digitize. I'll zoom in into this region here because it has a row of trees. Just highlight the trees in the Create Features window and then use the Point tool. All you need to do is click once where you think the tree trunk might be. When you're done digitizing all of your features, be sure to save your edits. Just go to the Edit ribbon and click the Save button. Attributes. Next, we're going to add some attributes to the shapefiles. Open the attribute table for the buildings layer. Let's create an area field. Click the Add button and name the field Area, then set the type as double. Close the Add Field window and save. To get the area for each building, I will run the Calculate Geometry tool. Right-click on the field name to open the tool. The property is area. The unit will be square feet. You can't calculate the area for the trees since point features don't have areas, but the streets have lengths to them. Go ahead and practice adding an attribute to your shapefile by adding a length field to the streets layer. Don't forget to calculate geometry to update the length values in feet. There are a few more attributes to add to your shapefiles. Be sure to read the written instructions for details. Creating metadata. Metadata is another important aspect of data creation. It tells the next person what your data is about. Now, our datasets are extremely simplistic, so it might not seem like a big deal. But you'll appreciate good metadata documentation once you start working in a larger organization. Before you add the metadata, let's just check the settings. Click on the word Project on the upper right, then go to the Options window. Scroll down and click Metadata. There are several different metadata styles, which will give you different options for editing. Make sure that the metadata style is set to ISO 19139. There are 2 of them, so just pick the plain one without the GML 3.2. Click the back button to get back to the project. You're going to use the catalog pane to start the process. This is the only place where your metadata will stick outside of this ArcPro session. Don't use the contents pane or the metadata won't be saved for later. Okay, so right-click on the building's shapefile in the catalog pane and choose Edit Metadata. Our main goal here is to eliminate all of these red X's. The written instructions provide you with a link to a metadata quick reference page. Take a moment to read through that documentation to get a sense of the type of information you're going to provide in the metadata. Let's start with the item description section. For the title, I'm just going to use the name of the file. For the summary, you should provide a short description of the original purpose of this dataset. I'm going to write a collection of digitized buildings on the Cal Poly Humboldt campus. For the description, I'm going to write, this collection of buildings was manually digitized using ArcGIS Pro. We should probably add some information about the resolution of the NAIP image, so I'm going to save my edits and go back to my map to check that out. First, I want to check the image resolution. Just open the layer properties and go to the source tab. Under the raster information, I can see that the cell size is 1 meter. So the NAIP image has a 1 meter resolution. So what about the spatial accuracy of the polygons? This is going to vary widely based on how accurate you are. If I zoom in close to this building, I can see that about 1 to 3 pixels are sticking out. So I'm going to say that my accuracy is roughly 2 meters. Okay, so let's get back to the metadata. Notice that the red X next to the item description is gone. That's our goal. However, the written instructions ask you to provide a little more information. To continue the description, I'm going to write, the polygons were digitized from a NAIP image with a 1 meter resolution. The estimated accuracy of the polygons is about 2 meters. Lastly, I'm going to add that this dataset is for practice and demonstration and should not be used for other purposes. It's a good idea to save your edits as you work, just in case ArcPro decides to crash. Next, I'm going to fill in the credits. Just add your name and the year. So that's how you edit metadata. The instructions ask you to go through each of these sections and fill in the appropriate information. Remember, you want to get rid of the red X's. Use the Metadata Quick Reference Guide to help you understand what needs to be added. Be sure to save your metadata regularly. You're going to do this for each of your shapefiles. Compressing your working folder. After you are done, the final step is to compress your working folder so you can submit it on the assignment page in Canvas. When you are done, you should save your project and close ArcPro. Your working folder should only contain the data for the 3 shapefiles you created. Here are some potential problems to avoid. First, don't delete any of the component files. Remember, a shapefile is made up of about 3 to 5 different files, not just the .shp file. You need all of them. Second, make sure that the NAIP image is not stored here. It's a huge file and takes forever to download. Your lab instructors don't want to deal with that. You can compress your working folder in Microsoft Windows File Explorer. Just right-click, Show More Options, then go to 7-zip. Use the option Add to Working.7z. The total file size of the 7z file should be less than 10 kilobytes. Mine is only 4, but that's because I didn't include all of the information that you would. Just make sure it's not gigabytes in size. Rename the file and add your last name before working. And you're done. You'll upload this 7z file to the assignment page in Canvas. Thanks for watching.